Well, good afternoon, everybody. And I think you've had a full day. I think you've had various sessions from various experts, and they've all spoken on various issues. So what I will do is I will not touch upon entrepreneurship because I think many of the speakers have already spoken. And please bear with me. I'll make the session as interesting as possible and as educative as possible. I'm sure once we finish the session, you will go back with much more knowledge. And today's talk, as you see, is Atmanirbhar Bharat, Innovative Educators. Now, I will just run through some of the slides which it is possible some of the speakers would have gone through. Now, I'll just run through some of the slides and then I will start with my talk. Now, you can see, just let me give you a brief introduction about myself. I have been in the IT industry for 23 years. I have worked under various US companies and various other companies, and I am with Acharya from 14 years. I am the former chairman of Computer Society of India. I am there in the IT panel of CII. I am there and as expert evaluation committee member with the All India Council for Technical Education, and I was an advisor to the state government on cybersecurity. So I have been a speaker at national level on various services. Anyway, now let me come to the topic. Now today I am going to talk about innovating the educator. Why it is important, I will come to that later. First, let me finish off my slides. Okay, fine. So the first slide, you can see, I think this Atmanirbhar Bharat, what do you mean by Atmanirbhar Bharat? I think many of the speakers would have explained to you, making India self-sufficient, self-reliable, and Now see, when you speak about making India self-sufficient, self-reliable, it is India is constituted and comprises of the people. So basically, now see, for example, I'll tell you, you build smart cities. When you build smart cities, if you don't have people who are smart enough to use the smart cities, if you have idiots using the smart cities, then it is not possible. So what you need to do is you need to upskill the people, you need to skill the people so that they are able to utilize the smart cities. Okay, so now what I'm going to talk about today, I will just run through these slides and then maybe before I touch upon my PPTs, I'll get the background also. So the world sees a new India. Our Prime Minister has taken various initiatives and Stand Up India, Startup India, Make in India. And at one of the talks in one of the forums, I was saying that it should not only be Make in India, Stand Up India, Startup India, but it should also be Design in India. We are missing that because it is being designed in China and it is being used in India. Okay, God knows what they are embedding in the operating system. God knows what they are embedding in the microchips, the microprocessors. Okay, what is being embedded? Okay, a lot of things are there. So what we need to add is Make in India, Build in India, Design in India. Okay, and Stand Up India, all these things are there, definitely. A lot of things are happening. And I think, basically, I think I'm speaking to the educators. Let me tell you, as educators, if we are not aware of what is happening around us, then I think there is no point in us being educators at all. At Madhya Pradesh, at Indore, I was giving a talk on Higher Education Summit. I was a keynote speaker. And many vice chancellors were sitting there. I'm a small man in front of the vice chancellors. I was a bit jittery and many of the newspapers were there covering. They came and asked me, sir, aapke topic ke baare mein hum kuch ye karna chahte hain. Then I said, bhai, mere se bade aadmi hain, bade bade aadmi vice chancellors baithe hain. Aap unka interview le lo aap. Unse baat kar lo aap. Okay. So some of the vice chancellors gave interviews. And then during the session, I was talking about the national education policy. That was my topic. In fact, one of my topics is published, one of the magazines that was released by AICT Chairman Shashidhar Buddhesa. Okay. Building and Branding India, I think a new challenge or something like that is there. I'll come to that. Okay, so during the talk, I just asked the elite members who were present, the NEP speaks about innovative index. I asked them, you are innovating? Yes. But how do you measure the innovator? How do you measure it? What is the yardstick? Okay, and what is the means of measuring that? None of them could answer it. So then I told them, it depends upon the number of IPRs that are generated. Okay, innovative index is measured by the number of IPRs that are generated. Okay, anyway, I'll come to all these things later. Okay, I think I should not stray from the topic. Let me come to the thing. So, okay, the world sees a new India. Okay, and I think you heard about the communication satellites, GSAT and various other satellites that we launched. And in fact, I'm an electronics engineer. I have worked with the IT industry. And in fact, I don't want to go through the work that I've done. I've also done a lot of innovative work. Okay. And so India joined the elite list of countries with their own satellite navigation system. And in fact, I have attended various meetings with ISRO also. Okay. And India is leading to the global shift towards renewable energy also. And you can see all the things. Harnessing Yuva Shakti, transforming India. And yes, I think educational infrastructure in tribal areas was boosted with all these things. Eklavya model residential schools. Then we had Atil tinkering labs. Okay. And then you also have 54,000 ramps and railings built for the children. Then next thing is, I want to touch upon this. Numerous universities established and made operational, recognizing talent for the Prime Minister Research Fellow, the same. And then institution of eminence. See, what is happening is, in the list of the countries that are evaluated by QS ranking or Shanghai ranking, India does not stand amongst the top 20 countries at all. None of the universities from India stand amongst the top 200 universities. IISc is way behind. Okay. So that is why the government of India wanted to enhance the rankings. They came out with the Institution of Eminence. And I was part of the Institution of Eminence team from Acharya. In fact, I was in the core committee. I was there at Delhi to make a presentation also on our Institution of Eminence. Okay. Now, Institution of Eminence, there are a lot of things. What they wanted was, within a period of 5 years, you need to come within the first 500 ranks. And within a period of 500, you need to be amongst the top 100. That is the vision that the government of India envisages. That is the vision that the government of India wants to endow upon the universities and to ensure. That is why they selected 20 institutes which were declared as institutions of eminence. And 60 universities were granted graded autonomy. A lot of autonomy was granted by passing the IIM bill, National Testing Agency, vigorous attention. All these things were happening. And yes, augmenting the skill and vocational training. A lot of initiatives. I don't want to go through the initiatives. I think you can just go through the website and you will get information about this. I'm going to spend much more time on, I think, how our educators need to be innovative. That is my theme for today. And for 2020, our Prime Minister raised a clarion call to give a kickstart to the Atmanirbhar Bharat Abhiyan. Atmanirbhar, that is making India self-reliant, making India self-sufficient. When you say India, the people of India constitute India, who make India. Okay. And special economic and comprehensive packages were announced. A lot of things happened. Let me skip these things. What do you mean by innovation? Now, people think they have a wrong concept on innovation. When they say innovation, they think that we need to invent something. We need to come out with something new. That is not at all innovation. Okay. Inventing is different from innovation. Okay. Creating is different from innovation. Entrepreneurship is different from innovation. Innovation can be part of entrepreneurship. I think the previous speaker, professor, has elaborated on entrepreneurship. I don't want to touch upon it. So innovation basically happens when someone improves or makes a significant contribution on something that is existing. You improvise or you come out with something new. Okay, change some pattern. That is called as innovation. And converting knowledge into a wealth is called as innovation. Okay, now let me come to this. Why am I talking about educating the innovators? Educating the the teachers. See, the educators are the people who build the nation. Whether you are an educationist, whether you are an economist, whether you are an entrepreneur, whether you are a politician, whatever you are, okay? And it is education that has contributed to your stand. And education builds a nation, or without education, the nation falls. Please remember, and remember, education is the passport to your prosperity. Whether you are an individual, you are in a developed or a country to be developed, okay, whether you are an entrepreneur, whether you are an academician, business or a government leader, the more knowledge you have, the more empowerment is there. And this is the nation's strength. That is why we call it as Atmanirbhar Bharat. Are you making your educators empowered? A developed nation is inevitably an educated nation. Secondly, we recognize the challenges facing the education system, which have a direct impact on the future of our industries. Now, Indian education, so higher education system is the third largest in the world next to US. India has the third largest higher education system in the world in terms of size. And in terms of diversity, and the number of education institutions, we are the largest. Okay. Now see what has happened is 11% of our youth are in higher education compared to 20% in China. Our gross enrollment ratio, gross enrollment ratio is basically number of people who followed, do not go to the higher school, is very less compared to China and some other countries. Once a professor wrote that if you want to collapse a nation, you don't require an atomic bomb, you don't require a hydrogen bomb, you don't require missiles. What you need to do is lower the quality of education and allow the students to cheat in the examination. So collapse of education is the collapse of a nation. Let me come to think. So I think IIT Kharagpur makes an appearance after Indian Institute of Science. Okay. And amongst the top 400. Before I come to this, let me tell you, the world has changed. When I did my engineering in the 1980s, I had not seen a computer. I was an electronics engineer from Harvey College of Engineering. But I did my master's, then I did my this thing. Okay. But we had not seen computers doing engineering. We did not see mobiles. And after that, a lot of things changed. And when I was working in an American company, I was just telling, I think in the last talk, okay, I was asked to set up a network connecting Bangalore, New Delhi, Sri Lanka with US, where my parent company was there. Okay, and what we did, I used instead of a leased line, because we require a static IP address. Okay, why do you require a static IP? When you dial, what happens is you get a dynamic IP address. It is like giving your house number keeps on changing. So the other person is not able to locate your house. If you have a fixed address, if you have a static address, then the other person is able to locate you. Same way, computers can talk to each other if you have a static IP address. So I used a static IP address from the government of India. Okay. And then the systems were able to talk to each other. But at that time, it was taking a long time for data to be transferred from Sri Lanka to my server and from Delhi to my server. And then I used to FTP it to my server in US. But now things are happening in fractions of a second. Things have changed. World has changed. The way we transact, the way we do business, the way we interact, the way we talk, everything has changed. Vehicles are able to communicate to each other. Vehicle to vehicle communication using IoT, machine learning, artificial intelligence. Just Monday, I delivered a keynote address, IPRN technology. I spoke about artificial intelligence. I spoke about machine learning. I spoke about deep learning. Okay, all these things. Anyway, I don't want to touch upon these things. Okay, and industry also has changed the standards. Industry 4.0. When I asked mechanical professors, what is Industry 4.0? None of them were able to answer. I said, what is Industry 1? No, they used water. Industry 2, what they used? Okay, Industry 3, they used ICs. Industry 4, they used cyber-physical systems. They were not aware. So my dear educators, if you are not going to be aware of the developments that are going to happen around you, you are the person who carries the marshal. You are the person who carries the beacon. And you are the person who are going to illuminate all the citizens of tomorrow. You are going to innovate them. You are going to educate them. And you do not know what is happening around you. You do not know what is the technology around you. Then what are you going to educate? What is the innovation that you're going to do? I hope you're able to follow me. Okay. Now everything is digital. Okay. And I was in US. Every year I go to US. I've seen the teaching there, how it happens. And we are still in the chalk and duster age. We are still writing on the board. We are still dictating notes. Is this the way education happens? No. I'm going to deal with all these things in detail. So let me tell you, technology should transform the learner outcomes. Follow me. Technology should transform the learner outcomes. And the new pedagogy requires students to create new knowledge and connect it to the world by using the power of digital tools. Social networking should be used to connect, collaborate, learn, and create. Okay. Now, employees have begun to seek out new skills to increase their competitiveness in a global marketplace. And let me come, what exactly the teachers need to do. So, in this digital age, are we going to stay behind? Are we not going to change the way pedagogy happens? Pedagogy is basically the process of teaching and learning. Okay. So, we need to adapt ourselves to the new technology. We need to have the digital technology, and we need to ensure that our students are involved with the digital technology. Okay. So, I don't know. I think I've not yet come to my slides. I don't know how much time I have. Okay. Now, some of the expectations from the University of Eminence were it should preferably be multidisciplinary and have both teaching and research focus of an exceptionally high quality. There should be a reasonably good mix of domestic and foreign students. I'll come to all these things. So these are some of the things. Okay. I think because I'm running behind time, I'll try to go a little faster. How much time do I have, Samaira?
So actually, the panel discussion is going to start at, was going to start at 4:55, but you can finish as the session is pretty interesting.
How much time do you have? So, another 10, 15 minutes?
Yes, sir.
I started at 4:40, I think I started. National Education Policy, I want to speak about the higher education institutions. By 2040, all higher education institutions should become multidisciplinary institutions. Okay, and they want to increase the gross enrollment ratio up to 50% by 2035. And autonomous degree granting colleges would grant undergraduate degrees with independent board of governors, etc., etc. UG degree will be made 4 years. Okay, now let me touch upon this. This is very, very important. Some of the essential points for discussion: national education policy, increase in international footprints. What do you mean by increase in international footprints? When you say increase in international footprints, it means that you need to have professors coming from abroad and delivering talks. You need to have our faculty going to the foreign institutions. You need to have students from abroad coming here for summer studies or vacation studies or whatever you call it. And likewise, you need to have, see, in Acharya, we are doing it. We have tied up with several institutions. We have had students coming from Russia. We have had students coming from Canada. We have had students coming from different countries. And likewise, our students go with Old Dominion University every year, except the last 2 years because of the pandemic. We have been sending our students for 1 month internship. Okay. So like this, this is increase in international footprints. Innovation index. I spoke to you that unless we increase and ensure that each faculty is able to generate one IPR at least, our innovation index will not increase. See, and let me tell you, there is what is called as Global Innovation Index. And we rank, there are about 130 countries and we are about 42nd in that Global Innovation Index. So I think unless we generate IPRs, we will not go up in the ladder. International of, yes, NIRF ranking has to be increased, better quality of education, choice-based credit system. A student should be able to select what is his majors and what is his minors. Okay, so he should be able to specialize a lot of things so he can select from a basket of things which is provided to him, he should be able to select a lot of things. Okay, and ecosystem has to be created to nurture research. So for this, I think the National Research Foundation has been created. Okay, standalone institutions will not survive. And a lot of things are there. Yes, the National Research Foundation, I think it's going to start from master's degree and they are going to ensure that there's a research component in the master's degree also. And it is going to encompass sciences, technology, social science, arts and humanities, besides strengthening the present weak support that subjects like social sciences and humanities receive. Okay, now see, what is the new age industry looking at? Okay, see, it's looking at the new pedagogy. I'm just going through a little fast. Now see, one thing is that MIT conducted research in which they saw lectures are equal to equal to a person sleeping. So how do you, this thing, you need to ensure that the students are involved in discussions. Okay, that gives much more better retention. Now in the, what are the industries looking at? Industries are looking at problem-solving skills, collaboration, creativity, thinking in different ways, and building effective relationships and teams. This is what the industry is looking at. Okay, you see, technical knowledge can be imbibed. Later, they can provide the technical knowledge. What is much more important is basic fundamental knowledge of the subject. That is much more important. Okay, so I think basically what we're looking at is problem-solving and decision-making skills, creative and critical thinking, collaboration, communication and negotiation, intellectual curiosity, and the ability to find, select, structure, and evaluate information. So basically, the new pedagogy. Learner is at the center. And what does the teacher do? The teacher will help facilitate, instruct, guide, and support as needed. Knowledge is available. Tons and tons of knowledge is available at the click of a mouse. What are you trying to provide to the student? Are you trying to provide knowledge to him? No. Knowledge is available. You need to facilitate. You need to ensure. You need to mentor him. Basically, that knowledge is deep learning. Deep learning is premised on human inquiry, getting deep into the subject, creativity, and purpose. Okay. Now, collaborative learning. See, what do you mean by collaborative learning? See, what happens is a number of students get together and then they try to build up a problem. It is called as problem-based learning or project-based learning, in which a number of students get together. They could be from the same class, they could be from different classes, they could be from same university, or they could be from different universities. And they build the knowledge that is called as collaborative learning. Okay. And then you need to use a lot of social media tools also. Now, some of the institutions, what they do is they have blogs and wikis. And what they do is they put all the data, the students put all the data, and then they invite experts to comment upon that. So they build knowledge using the blogs and wikis. Okay. And now next thing is constructivism. Basically, now see what happens is the teacher no longer delivers lectures every day. He comes once in a week. And in the meantime, the students go through a lot of things. There's what is called as also flipped learning. Okay. So what happens is in blended learning is that now blended learning, basically what happens is you are adopting both hybrid learning. That is, some of the classes are online, some of the classes are offline. Okay, that is blended learning. And now what happens is, I'm rushing through a little bit. Now, flipped learning, what happens is, the teacher puts up a number of videos, a number of questions, a number of information, everything on the web. The students go through it. And then when they come to class, class time is not, it is utilized for discussions. Okay, for discussions on various things. Okay, and they have weekly tutorials, feedbacks. Interdisciplinary project work. This is very, very important. See, if a robot is there, you cannot make it work without any coding. You cannot say that I'm a mechanical student. Sir, why should I learn that? Coding is not important for me. My dear students, whether it is a car which has been autonomous or wearable devices, anything that is there, everything, even for pharmacy students, I was giving a talk. Remote patient monitoring is there using IoT. Okay, artificial intelligence also is being used. Industry 4.0, what is it doing? Cyber-physical systems, IoT, iOS, everything is being used. So prediction is being done and also forecasting is being done and predictive maintenance, just-in-time maintenance is being done in Industry 4.0. So what happens is, don't be under the impression that you are a mechanical engineer, you are a biotechnology engineer. Everywhere, technology thread runs through everything. Okay, so don't be under the illusion. So multidisciplinary and interdisciplinary is very, very essential. Please remember that. You want me to conclude or do I have another 5 minutes, Samira?
So it's a request to conclude as fast as you can, sir.
Okay, so I'll try to wind up. So I didn't have much time. What I would like to stress is that technology should transform the learner outcomes. Then new pedagogy requires students to create new knowledge and connect to the world by using the power of digital. Social networking should be used to connect, collaborate, learn, and create. Employers have begun to seek new skills. Okay. And see, employers want the best. And what are we producing? That is why we are not able to satisfy the industry. The skills that we produce are not compatible to the requirements of the industry. Okay. So we need to produce skills that are compatible to the requirements of the industry. And industry wants top talent, especially solid foundation is essential. Okay. And teachers, what they need to do is that it is not going to be teacher-centered, it is going to be student-centered. Okay, and as per the national education policy, everything has to be interdisciplinary and it has to be problem-based learning or it has to be project-based learning. Okay, so basically this is how we need to transform the students and this is going to help us make India much more strong, and make the citizens of India Atmanirbhar, self-reliant, self-sufficient, and I'm sure this will help build a much more stronger country that the Prime Minister is trying to build. So thank you all very much. I think I could speak only for about 25 minutes. I had to cut short my talk, although I would have spoken for a much longer time. So thank you. I hope I have done justice to my talk. I was a bit fast. Time was very short. I hope I've done justice to you. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Iqbal Ahmed. Amazing session. Such an inspiring figure you are out there. More respect to you, sir. And unfortunately, we are running out of time, like you said, and somebody has raised a hand and I'm going to shine the spotlight on this person, Aradhya Joshi. Now, Aradhya Joshi, you can unmute yourself right now and you can ask the question to our honorable mentor, Dr. Iqbal. So I have a really personal question to you. And if you only allow me, I would ask this question to you.
Sure. Please go ahead, Samantha.
Awesome. Okay. So as the topic for today's webinar, it's Atmanirbhar Bharat, right? So I have this little knowledge. I would translate directly it to self-reliant India. But I think for a self-reliant India, you know, obviously you have to have self-reliant Indians, like each individual has to be self-reliant. But deep down, I believe that to be self-reliant, you have to be enthusiastic. But there are some days that a person doesn't feel enthusiastic at all. But, you know, seeing a person like you, very inspiring, very successful in your field, sir, don't you ever feel, like I said, it's a personal question, don't you ever feel like the opposite of enthusiastic? And if so, how do you deal with the situation and still, you know, reach to a point where you are right now, sir?
Well, Samira, there are two sides of this coin. Okay. One thing is, I think it is up to our educators to ensure that they create the enthusiasm amongst the students. Okay, now if you are going to deliver a lecture and walk out, the students will get bored. That is what we are doing. I've been to the universities in US also. I sat in a class and the teacher was sitting with me, next to me, the professor was sitting. And you will not believe it, there was a debate going on between the one person who was presenting a project, a live project, and another American. And the teacher was not at all interfering. He said, just keep quiet and listen. And the debate, and the guy from America, he said, no, I don't agree with you this thing at all. Are we enthusiastic like that? Are we creating that type of environment? Okay, are we trying to bring in live projects? Are we trying to make it more interactive? No, we are not doing it. I think as educators, we are failing. One thing. Second thing, as students, are we... Now see, take my example. I did my engineering long back. I give talks on cybersecurity. Just on Monday, I delivered a talk on artificial intelligence and deep learning and flip learning. How do I do it? Does it just come? Did I learn that about 30, 40 years back? No, I am enthusiastic. I'm a learner. I believe that you are a learner till you die. Okay, so you need to be enthusiastic. You need to take interest in whatever you do. And if you're going to do it just because of stress and somebody's forcing you, you will never succeed. So what I would say is take interest and feel that you are part of that thing. Take responsibility for it and enjoy what you're doing. Unless you enjoy, you will not be enthusiastic. And never give up. I have said, even if you fail, every failure is a stepping stone to success. So don't look. See, my own son, he was doing his graduate, this thing, he gave it up. I forced him. But again, after that, he started this thing. Now he's working in US and now he has become self-reliant. He's standing on his own feet. So what happened is still sometime I was forcing him. He was not enjoying it. Now he has realized the importance, the necessity of education, the necessity of working, and he's standing on his own feet. He's enjoying his work.
Awesome. Amazing. So, from Dr. Iqbal Ahmed, do what you love and love what you do and never give up. So beautiful lessons from you. Thank you so much, sir, for being with us.